Camille Colatosti, the Dean for Institutional Assessment and Graduate Studies, and we're glad you could join us. Today we are talking about tonal harmony and composition and the art of counterpoint. This series, this event is part of a series of events that we run here at Berklee College of Music to share information about our curriculum and our pedagogy, how we teach, with members of our partner institutions, with our campus in Valencia, Spain, as well as with campuses who are part of our Berklee International Network. So for all of you who could join us here in person, thank you, and please continue to help yourself to lunch. For those who are joining us virtually, we're sorry that we cannot share a meal with you, but we're happy that you were able to spend some time with us. To introduce today's events and today's speakers, it is my pleasure to introduce one of our deans here at Berklee College of Music, Dean Kari Usala, who is the dean of the Professional Writing and Music Technology Division. Thank you.
Thank you, Camille, and welcome both people here and virtually. This department is very near and dear to me, being a composer myself, and I think that Berklee, we've always recognized the importance of although you use tonal harmony here, but traditional harmony as opposed to contemporary harmony, which is really the foundation of all our contemporary studies. And so we've decided here at Berklee that we're going to have this as a required course, two required courses in tonal harmony and the art of counterpoint, along with conducting. So those are our traditional studies. And we have two wonderful chairs, who are great friends of mine, and wonderful composers and musicians themselves to lead this department. And so I'd like to introduce Arnold Friedman and Greg Glancey. And they're going to share about these two classes, where I have three classes, the two tonal harmony classes and the art of counterpoint. So welcome, Arnold and Greg.
Thank you, Kari. Thank you, Camille. And also thank you to Mary McClory, who is the administrative assistant at the Institutional Assessment Department and has been incredible help in getting us organized for today. Greetings and welcome from snowy Boston. Thank you for joining us today. We're very happy to be here to present this part of the Berklee Composition Department's curriculum. I'm Arnold Friedman, and Greg and I will be talking very quickly through these three courses. There's a tremendous amount that we could talk about. We're going to sort of hit some highlights and try to give a real feel of how we approach it. Necessarily we'll skirt over a lot of details. Just one quick clarification. These courses used to actually have the title traditional in them. And a few years ago, we made the deliberate decision that the title tonal would better suit them because though we, of course, are representing what you might call a traditional classical Western European tradition, the traditions that Berklee students come from are so many and so varied that it seemed like tonal was both a more accurate and also more inclusive way to title these courses. And as you'll see, we're all about connecting these earlier practices with today's music. So that applies both to our tonal harmony and to the counterpoint curriculum. And it is the beginning of the answer to a natural question that comes up from Berklee students. Why do we have to take these courses? Now, Greg and I could spend a long time ourselves answering those questions, but we had a chat recently with a very successful Berklee alumnus, songwriting major, George Woods, and he put it for us quite well, so we're going to listen to his answer.
The thing that your class and Counterpoint in general really demystified about the entire Berklee curriculum is that when you start looking at each note in a chord or in a two-part melody or in a rock song or punk song, anything, as literally two voices moving around, suddenly the entire thing makes more sense. It improved my guitar playing, and it definitely improved my arranging and orchestration and things like that. And since then, and oh yeah, and additionally to that, it got me to the point where I could actually sit down with a pen and a piece of paper. I think I have since lost this ability, but I remember being in class with you, and you were talking about some counterpoint exercise, and I just sat down with a pen and a piece of paper, and I was able to write out a three-part piece of counterpoint that sounded exactly like what it sounded in my head without a piano in front of me. And I handed it to you, and you just played it off, and I was like, wow, I'm really impressed with myself right now. And mainly it was because...
So that connection of the paper, the pen, or a computer, if you will, and the ear, the inner ear, is a huge part of why we teach what we teach, and kind of freeing up one's abilities, being able to apply these techniques and these principles to any kind of music. So we'll start with tonal harmony 1 and 2, CM 211 and 212 in our cataloging system. And another important point about these courses is that the full title is Tonal Harmony and Composition. Composition is emphasized right from the beginning, applying the principles of melody, harmony, voice leading, and form that creates and actualizes the goal of composition. And to kind of encourage this, the best final projects from the Tonal Harmony 2 classes are performed every year in a concert by our colleague Fran Trester. We have one of those coming up next week. We have, we're going to play just about half minute here of an example from last year's concert. And I think you'll hear both that the student is capturing the essence of voice leading and harmony as it's taught, but he's taking it beyond that to something that's very free and frankly, very beautiful. This is a piece, the composer's name is Nathan Droub, and the title in French is Beau Yeux. So I think you can agree that that's a really wonderful composition. We're also about connecting everybody that is making music with this incredible tradition, this incredible heritage, when we're teaching a basic kind of four-part voice leading, which this Bach chorale here is an example of, we can illustrate. And let's just listen to a couple of phrases from this chorale.
Amen.
So probably most of you are familiar with that from the St. Matthew Passion. Actually, the particular setting we were listening to is not the one we have up here, but the same melody and just a different harmonization. You learn a lot from Bach about reharm. But there's also a connection with this particular chorale with a more contemporary piece, which let's listen to that for a moment.
Many's the time I've been mistaken, and many times confused. Yes, and I've often felt forsaken, and certainly misused. Oh, but I'm all right, I'm all.
So where's the connection? Why did Paul Simon take this old German hymn and turn it into an American tune? I don't know this for a fact, but I think that this is just an exquisite metaphor that he's creating, because if you know this song, he's really talking about the experience of immigrants coming to America, probably thinking about his grandparents, great-grandparents coming from Eastern Europe, being processed through Ellis Island. And once they're through, having to make of their lives, you know, whatever they brought from the old country, making them American lives. And he's done the same thing with this old German hymn tune, some of the same changes, too, that Bach uses in his settings. So creating this sense of connection with this amazing heritage that goes back, you know, 1,500 years is also a big part of what we do. Now, one other point in looking at this chorale score, because of course this kind of writing, four-part choral writing, is a big part of practicing voice leading and the so-called rules that we work with. And of course there are those little numbers under the bass line, what's called figured bass. This points up a difference in approach between the tonal, or if you will, traditional harmony and more contemporary jazz pop harmony that Berklee students learn in MAT in Harmony 2 and 3 and 4, which is in the more contemporary classes, the approach is more kind of top-down from the melody down to the chords. And with at least figured bass, we're working from the opposite direction. And I can tell you as a cellist, I'm very appreciative of somebody who thinks a lot about a bass line, making it melodic, making it an important part of the texture. So that is a very essential element to our training in tonal harmony 1 and 2, and actually also in counterpoint, as we'll talk later. Now, another subject that we spend a lot of time talking about is non-chord tones. And here again is a distinction that puts something that's already familiar to our students into a different context in their MAT and harmony classes. They talk about tensions, tension 9, tension 11, tension 13, that are kind of visitors and color tones to chords. On the other hand, in tonal harmony and in counterpoint, we're talking a lot about non-chord tones. And these are essentially melodic phenomena. They are part of voices, not just the melody, but all the voices can participate in this. And there are basically two ways they come about, one through kind of interpolation, so a passing tone or a neighbor tone, kind of extra notes that help to smooth or make a line more interesting. There's also temporal kind of distancing or temporal displacements. That's what the suspension is about. So I'm going to go over to the piano here for a second. You'll see two different versions of this Bach chorale here, Wer Gott vertraut. And if I play the first version, which is just block chords, I'll just play the first couple of phrases. It It's quite beautiful on its own. Of course, the harmony is gorgeous. But what Bach actually has written, and which we'll hear now sung chorally, is so much more expressive, because if you watch the alto line there now, that the delaying of the third of that five chord, and similarly in the next phrase, creates a whole new and powerful emotional atmosphere that doesn't exist without it. Now we'll hear the choral version. So it's so important always to emphasize that all these devices, these techniques that we're learning, that we're teaching, are ultimately at the service of musical expression. And they don't just exist for their own technical sakes. Now I'm going to turn things over to Greg, and he's going to continue talking about the tonal harmony sequence.
So a little bit more about voice leading. I'm presenting an example here of a very nice, boring, two-line composition. I say boring because a lot of times these exercises can seem tedious and that they don't relate really to making good music. What I want to do is have us sing this, if we could do this as a group. Just pick a line, top or bottom, it doesn't matter. It's not too bad. You can use solfege if you like.
Just to make you feel more comfortable, I'll sing too.
Some of the things that we're teaching our students is good line writing at a really pure musical form. So you notice rhythmically it's not very interesting, but we can work on contours. For example, the top line reaches up to that G and then comes back down to C. It has a really good arc. Whereas the bottom line starts in middle C, winds up reaching below to F and comes back up. So the two lines have a good contour. They're also primarily stepwise. And in addition, when you do leaps are very expressive. When we do leap, look at the C to the G, it's balanced by step in the opposite direction. These are principles that students are learning. When comparing the two lines together, we like to put the intervals in between there. And this is an exercise we do in counterpoint as well, but this is also very much related to the four-part writing we do in tonal harmony. Consonant intervals dominate. Okay, as a matter of fact, this is entirely consonant intervals, except at the end, fourths are considered dissonant, and you'll see that it has a harmonic implication here as well. The other thing is, if you look at the two lines, when one is going up, the other's going down, and vice versa. We aim for contrary motion. You can't always have it, but you aim to have primary contrary motion to create good line independence. And then with all of that, students are also recognizing the implied harmonies that exist when you put two lines together. And we're also teaching them that chords actually come out of the motion of independent lines being put together. And so some of the things, you notice that you have choices. When you only have two notes, you could come up with a couple of different chords. But we're also teaching students that there are common progressions and common harmonic progression principles that exist. For example, 1-5-1, tonic, dominant, tonic, and then at the end here, 1-2-6, 1-6-4-5-1, tonic, subdominant, dominant, tonic. These are common patterns. We teach them how to find them, how to write them. So this example, at a pure musical form, really shows a lot of things. Now, it really isn't just a boring musical example. This is actually a textural reduction of a very famous piece, and I actually would like everyone to sing the lines as I play this. We'll see if we can do that. But in case you don't recognize this piece, fairly convincing that that melody is an elaborated version of the top line, and the bottom is an elaborated accompaniment of that bottom bass line. So the point of this, the voice leading, we're not just, you know, we do want them to write chorales. I mean, that's basically what we're doing in tonal harmony, but there's a deeper element here. We believe that these exercises train students in their ability to perceive structure at a deeper level below the surface. And likewise, when they're writing their own music, that intuitively they're going to have these linear structures guiding where their music is going. So there's really two deeper elements that come out of this. And this is a great example because it represents a phrase. We end on a half cadence and then the music goes on. So we also teach students about phrase, cadence, how to combine phrases to create bigger sections, and then combining sections to create bigger pieces, binaries and ternaries, so on and so forth. And then if you look at the piano accompaniment, you'll see that it is a very tight voice leading texture as well. So we work a lot through writing piano accompaniments, and you saw in Nathan's piece that he had very elaborate piano accompaniment which was tied together through great voice leading. So in tonal harmony too, then, we carry these principles, but we add some layers of complexity, one of them being chromaticism, and that comes in a couple of forms. First of all, tonicization, secondary dominance, 5 of 5, 5s of 4, so on and so forth. We explore modulation to closely related keys as well as distant. We do some chromatic medians, third relationships. We have the augmented 6 chord, which they've already been exposed to as the 5 sub 5 of 5 in their harmony classes. Neapolitan, flat 2. Mode mixture, borrowing chords from the minor to use in major, adds a lot of color, a lot of expression. There's altered dominance, things you can do to the 5 chord with chromaticism, extended tertians like flat 9s, flat 13s. Now, it's important to note that these are not just cool chords that someone can use willy-nilly in their compositions. These chords all have particular functions, and it's because they possess, all of them will possess what we call tendency tones, tones that need to move. So again, we're coming to the horizontal, the linear element of music. And here's an example I want to go through quickly. If we look at the progression, the beginning here, we go through one tonic, subdominant, dominant. But then the interesting stuff comes, and if you can see the shades, I've got a couple of the chromatic chords highlighted. Do you want to play this?
Sure.
Spot. So let's focus on the chords that are shaded. You have a 5 of 4. You have an Italian 6, which is our German. Augmented 6 chord. And then we have a German augmented 6 chord down here in the second phrase. The important thing here is that 5 of 4, passing through a 4, then to the augmented 6 chord, is doing this contrary motion line. And you can see how these chords work in a linear layout. These tendency tones are wanting to move. That F sharp is wanting to move to the G, as well as when we hit the B flat with the G sharp, that is wanting to expand out to the A. And Arnold, if you could just play measure 3 into 4. Yeah, so this is a great example to show students that these chords are not just things you throw in to your texture. You have to use them in particular ways. And likewise, the German six is the chord that ushers us into the modulation, but it's really the D sharp. So if you just play that, you can hear. Yep. So I'm gonna, I'll go ahead and do this. I have another example here of a very famous piano sonata, Beethoven Moonlight Sonata. And this is a great example showing the Neapolitan six. So a really wonderful example, and what I've done here is I've laid out a reduction of it showing the voice leading. You could see it's just great voice leading. These are very much like exercises we have our students do over and over and over again. And you can see that this reduced texture has lines that function in particular ways, and specifically that flat two. That flat two is really creating this tendency, this drive down to one, and the way it's typically used is we go from that flat two to the leading tone and then to one. So that's really where the color of that chord comes in. It is in that subdominant function and those tones moving. And I can't stress enough, and we all do this, we talk about this frequently, myself, Arnold, and our colleagues, about bringing in contemporary examples. And I have a example of a contemporary tune that has a Neapolitan in it. I'll go ahead and play it. Let Lionel Richie sing it. Normally I would croak it out in the classroom, but not here.
I sometimes see you pass outside my door. Hello.
It's pretty clear where that chord came, right? The B flat, there's the Neapolitan. There are actually two chords that he uses which possess tendency tones, and he takes them where they need to go. The tendency tones are resolved, but it's interesting. These are great examples to bring in the classroom because I find that students identify with text painting. If you can talk about what's going on in the lyrics and then why that chord is there and working the way it works, the five of four creates this tendency to move to the four, right? It's because we insert a C sharp on that A chord. And it's interesting that Lionel Richie is saying, is it me you're searching for? Because it's kind of a searching chord. But more importantly, the line, like the key line of this chorus is, you're all I've ever wanted. And he even stresses all, right when he hits that B flat chord, all has an agogic accent. That's really the line that sums up the whole song. And he inserts the Neapolitan there. Now, this example is actually in our Tonal Harmony textbook, and it's an example to demonstrate a circle of fifths progression, or a cycle five. You'll notice D to G to C to F. Normally, we would want to hear the two diminished chord or a half-diminished chord, but Lionel Richie uses that B flat to give it more weight, more tendency, more color. Actually, more tension is really what he's after. So this is a great example to show that all these principles are operating in contemporary music, and our professors do a great job of bringing in examples, jazz, world music, contemporary, and having students bring in their own examples. Because it's important for students to walk out of our classes with critical ears, active ears actually, listening to the music that they're playing and also that they're purchasing and taking in. So great example to show a lot of different things here. And I also wanted to show his voice leading. This is actually a breakdown of how he plays his accompaniment. And you'll notice the 4-7-3-6, the cycle 5, the circle of fifths, he voice leads it perfectly. The way that we actually do it in our tonal harmony classes, we're teaching them, you gotta create a sequence in your voice leading. And Lionel Richie is doing it here, probably intuitively. So I found that to be interesting as well. And there's the arrow showing the tendency tones. This I'm going to leapfrog over for time, but this is a famous piece by Schumann, which uses a flat 6. I thought it would be more interesting to show that flat 6 in a Bruno Mars song, since he just performed at the Super Bowl. So let me talk through this, and then we'll play it. He's cycling through a very standard progression, subdominant, dominant, tonic, 4-5-1. That's when he's saying all the should-haves. I should have done this, I should have done that. We hear it over and over again. Then in the middle verse there, the third line down, take you to every party because all you wanted to do was dance. That 4-5-6 is going to be a deceptive cadence. So now we're wanting one. We want to know how we're going to get back there. He goes through a D major chord, which is a 5-5, does not take it where you expect, takes that F sharp down to an F, but we're back on the F. And what are we expecting? We're going to expect 4-5-1, subdominant, dominant, tonic. But instead, he inserts this lovely F minor chord, which has a flat 6, okay, flat 6 scale degrees, borrowing it from the minor, and it's right on the kicker. It's the punch in the gut, where he says, now my baby's dancing, but she's dancing with another man. That's the line that makes everybody cringe. So let's hear Bruno.
Too young, too dumb to realize that I should have bought you flowers and held your hand. Should have gave you all my hours when I had the chance. Take you to every party cause all you wanted to do was dance. Now my baby's dancing, but she's dancing with another man.
Painful, isn't it? See? So the point of this, these voice leading exercises lead to very practical outcomes and really do train our students to think deeper, as well as the treatment of chromaticism is a linear issue. And when students understand that, and you know, bringing in examples like this really helps students connect the dots. Now, we already talked about Nathan's piece, so Arnold is going to continue on with some deeper elements in counterpoint.
Okay, thanks, Greg. We're just kind of running against the clock here, so I'll be scurrying through some of this, but when we start counterpoint, we're starting from square one, which is melody. Because ultimately the goal when we're writing counterpoint is to write 2 or 3, 4, possibly more independent melodic lines that will go together harmonically. But of course, first we need those good elements of melody. So going all the way back to the Middle Ages, all the way back to Gregorian chant, and I particularly love this example, Unquaeunt Loxies. Some of you may know a little bit from your music history the importance of this chant, but if you follow along here, unquaeunt loxies, re zonar mi fa. You see the highlighted syllables there are solfege, and this is the chant that Guido d'Arezzo back. Around 1,000 somewhere, so over 1,000 years ago, chose this as the basis for this new way to teach singing, which we know now as solfege. So this is another one of those great heritage moments when we see that something we're using today in our sight singing and ear training classes goes back 1,000 years. Now, the other thing that's nice about this tune, you can see why when I start singing in my classes, my students laugh, is the way this line is shaped. So it starts with a little rise, and then you go to the end of that first line. There's a little higher rise, then the next line rises a little higher. And so it's constantly curving up and down. And this kind of multi-curvature is a very important element of good melody writing. All right, so second element of successful melody writing when we're writing tonal music is melodies that have very strong harmonic implications in and of themselves. And now, so we jump ahead here to the music of Bach. And no better example of that than his cello suites, where he has essentially a single-lined instrument playing by itself. How does that project harmony? Let's listen. All right, so of course, this starts in C minor, and you can hear and see that at the beginning, all the pitches of the C minor chord are being emphasized. They're being placed on strong beats in the first bar. And of course, the B natural there is leading us back. In the next bar on the strong beats, D, B natural, G, we're getting the dominance. So right away, the key is being established in a very strong way. Now, what happens in the course of the next six bars is that there's a modulation that takes place. And Bach does this, skipping ahead a little bit here, but in bars five and six, by emphasizing the notes of B-flat 7, which is the 5 of E-flat, and then bars 7 and 8, emphasizing the notes of E-flat. So just through rhythmic positioning, and good use of the scale, a melody projects its own harmony. Now, if you have two melodies that are doing that in cooperation, that's where counterpoint begins to really work well. A third element of good melody writing is the development of motives. And here we reach into another piece that is often attributed to Bach, but actually was collected by him for his own kind of teaching manual, which we know as the Anna Magdalena Bach Notebook, the minuet in G. And just very quickly here, if we take that opening motive, dum ba da 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 dum bum bum, and we can put it through all sorts of manipulations. Transposition, inversion, fragmenting it, displacing it, even running it backwards. Now, if we look at what Petzold, the original composer, actually did with it, we discover that there's this wonderful kind of organic growth to the melody that from one end to the other, that opening motive transforms into something quite different. And again, we'll just go through this really quickly. I can share this handout with anyone who might be interested. With this piece, the strength of it did not escape some songwriters from the Motown days, which some of you may be familiar with, the Lover's Concerto. That's the Supremes version of that song. There are many, many, many covers of it. I think I counted like 8 of them on iTunes. Well, so the kind of traditional steps of learning counterpoint, that is the steps to Parnassus, the Fuchs method with the various species, we do something similar. We call it ratio counterpoint because it's tonal rather than modal. But going through ratios of 1-to-1, 2-to-1, 3-to-1, 4-to-1, syncopated counterpoint with suspensions, and finally arriving to a point where the voices can interact more or less freely. And sort of the goal, at least in Art of Counterpoint 1, is to be able to write one voice that can counterpoint against itself, a canon. And we have a really nice example here by the German composer Georg Philipp Telemann. And before we play it, let me just point out, so this is, he wrote this for, could be any two treble instruments. We'll hear it played by two flutes. Right away, we have a suspension in the first bar. And as the piece goes on, it actually modulates, and we won't get to it today, but near the end, he manages to work his way back around to the original melodic form, so that there's a real sense of formal cohesion. It's not just this technique. Let's listen to just a bit. So the elements of imitation, good counterpoint, and some of the chromaticism that students have learned or will learn in Tonal Harmony 2 all come into play here. So we're going to leave you with one more canon. The student may ask, you know, where could this technique be used in contemporary music? Well, we have Freddie Mercury's answer to that, the Prophet's Song, a chunk of it from... I wish we could listen to that whole thing. That's such an amazing, amazing thing. And that was all tape delay back then, no digital. And he didn't have auto-tune either. He was pretty good. So anyway, I hope that, and we hope, that gives you a sort of an overview of our approach, our philosophy in teaching tonal harmony and counterpoint. Of course, there are many, many more details, which we're more than happy to share. And you can see our contact information if you're watching us from afar or delayed. You can also get our contact information from Camille, and we're more than happy to answer any questions. And are there any questions now? Everybody's stunned. Thank you so much, and we really enjoyed presenting for you today, and thanks again.
Yeah, thank you all. That was wonderful. Special thanks to our production crew. Let's give them a round of applause. Please help yourself to some more food. Mary McClory and I will send out the slides to everyone. That was really a fascinating presentation. And really instructive about how we teach these important concepts here at Berklee. So thank you all again.